Good morning, everyone. This is Wednesday, November 5th, 2014. We are in the Eileen Dondero Foley Council Chambers. This is the Joint Budget Committee meeting, the first meeting. And I'd like to just say that good morning, everyone. Thanks for everyone being here, and I'll introduce the participants here. A few weeks ago, I recommended to the City Council that we bring back the Joint Budget Committee to look at the budget for the next fiscal year. The City Council ratified that, so here we are this morning. We have a full agenda. We have at least one presentation from Mr. Wilhenko and Judy Belanger. And I'd just like to talk about the charge of the committee at this point, just for people at home. The charge of the committee is she'll advise the City Manager and City Council on the adoption of guidelines for the preparation of proposed FY16 budget by January 15th. City staff will provide information to the committee on factors impacting the development of the municipal budget. Those include health insurance rates, retirement rates, contractual obligation impacts, and any other and all information which would impact the operating budget. The JBC format, the Joint Budget Committee format, is anticipated to have one meeting a month from September through March. Agenda will be put together by the mayor and the city manager with input from various departments and elected officials. At the beginning of each meeting, opportunity for any elected official to bring up a topic and speak to it will be available. At the end of each meeting, we will have an opportunity for citizens to speak if they would like to do that. The committee shall not assume responsibilities for the city manager or the city council as outlined by the city charter. If I may just talk about the members on the JBC, there are seven voting members, the mayor, two city councilors, and I've asked Councilor Spear and Councilor Thorson to participate, and they've gladly accepted. Two school board members, Jeff Landry and Nancy Noveling-Clayburg, Fire Commission member Jennifer Mathis, and Police Commission member John Gollum. Five non-voting ex officio members include the City Manager John Wilhenko, Finance Director Judy Belanger, Superintendent of Schools Ed McDonough, Fire Chief Stephen Achilles, and Police Chief Stephen Dubois. And with that, if I just can just go over the agenda, and that would include a call to order, which we have done, an opportunity for elected officials' comments who are non-JBC members, review of the city charter as it pertains to the budget process, that'll be a presentation by City Manager Mr. Wilhenko, an overview of the budget process, City Manager John Wilhenko and Finance Director Judy Belanger, establish a schedule of meetings, give an opportunity for public comment and our adjournments. That would be the agenda for this morning. Again, I appreciate all the time that everyone's putting into this. This is a very important task that we all have to look at the city budget and make sure we look at what the needs of the city are and come up with guidelines. So with that, I would like to, we have any, if I can open public comment, do we have any
elected officials?
Non-officials who would like to speak? And officials, non-JBC members? I don't see anyone in the audience, so I'm gonna move on and turn it over to Mr. Wilhenko and Judy Belanger.
Thank you, Your Honor. Before we get into the presentation, just a couple of things background for those of you that have not been or have not been an elected official when the Joint Budget Committee was in place a few years ago. When I arrived in Portsmouth in 1997, there were some issues with the budget, so I, working with the mayor at that time, Eileen Foley, and the assistant mayor, Alex Hansen, we put together the Joint Budget Committee so the various charter departments could come together and talk about some of the major issues that were common to all departments as we went forward to develop the fiscal year budget. It worked out very well, and after a few years, we were, I think, pretty much on a good standard program that we were using and getting the information out, and we had a lot of dialogue among the various departments. The mayor and the council, through their retreat, decided that they wanted to reactivate the Joint Budget Committee because of the need for them to try to establish some budget guidelines. And as the mayor said, the JBC is asked to recommend some budget guidelines by January 15th. One of the things I would ask, though, is if we could move that up to January 5th, because if we wait till January 20th for the second council meeting, I think we're going to be deep into the budgets, and some of the charter departments have their public hearings that they have to take place. So maybe instead of once a month, maybe for the next couple months, we could maybe meet twice a month, and I'll defer to the committee when we get to that item on the agenda. What I'd like to do now is talk a little bit about the charter. You know, here we are as the Joint Budget Committee, and it's really advisory. It's to give me guidance as I put together the budget for the City Council and for the community. So looking forward, I have a little problem with this, Judy.
You do?
Yeah, why don't you move it forward? Go ahead, just move forward. Oh, yeah, we're locked. Yeah, okay.
Is it on?
Well, your computer should work it. So. I was just using it, so.
I was just using it.
Yep. All righty. Well, as we, what I've done is, so as Judy's trying to get through that, what I've done is I've provided you all with a budget schedule. You all have a copy of the budget schedule.
I'll
be referring to that in my comments. The first item on the screen, and also we have provided you with copies of the presentation so you can take with you. I think that you'll find the presentation very interesting in terms of what is needed from your various departments and from the city manager's office and from the city council. So starting off, we've already sent out a memorandum. Many of you have it. All the department heads have it. The planning board initiates a six-year capital plan process. In October, we sent out a memorandum to all departments asking for them to prepare their capital plan for the upcoming fiscal year. This capital plan is a six-year capital plan. It's both required under state statute and in our charter. The Planning Board CIP subcommittee meets with and reviews the capital projects, and that will happen in December, that they will meet with the various departments. Many of you have already gone through that, and so you know the whole process. For those of you that are commissioners or board members, you have delegated that responsibility to your departments, either the superintendent or the chief of police or chief of fire, to bring forward to the subcommittee. The subcommittee reviews all the proposals that have come forward, and then it goes to the planning board, who holds a public hearing and votes to submit the CIP recommendations to the city council. That comes in January, February. The city manager prepares and submits a CIP to the city council, and you can see the citations of the charter. So if you're interested, you can go look online and look up the charter and see what it actually says in the charter. One thing that is interesting here is we have to get the CIP out 3 months before I submit the budget to the council. That's an item within the charter. So we need to follow the guidelines, and we need to follow this schedule pretty rigorously so that we adhere to the charter. City Council holds a public hearing on the CIP, and that's in accordance with Section 7.7 of the City Charter, and then the City Council adopts the CIP, and that's in accordance with 7.8 of the City Charter. And the reason I'm bringing this up, go ahead, Judy, next one, please. The reason I'm bringing this information together is that people need to understand that the issue of following the charter is important. You know, even though we have this Joint Budget Committee, I really think everybody needs to know that I have certain regulatory requirements under the charter that I need to follow. I will be welcoming and encourage those types of inputs on the budget. I think if we all are in agreement on how we want to move forward for the services of the community, I think it's better for everybody. So the city manager then initiates the budget process with the city departments. In the next couple of weeks, we'll be having a department head meeting to go over the calendar for the budget and the format for the budget. Each department submits the budget to the city manager in March. The fire commission, police commission, school board holds their public hearings prior to the submission to the city council. Then down here, the city manager presents the proposed budget to the city council. Now, one thing has to happen before I submit it. The city council has to adopt the capital improvement plan before I can submit a budget to the city council. City council holds public hearings on the budget. In past few years, the city council has chosen to leave the public hearing open. For many years, we had one public hearing on the budget and just moved forward on that. City Council adopts the budget on or prior to June 30th this would be 2015. If the City Council does not adopt the budget by June 30th, the budget that the city manager submits to the City Council becomes law. So I think that's important to understand. I don't think that will ever happen, but I just think that's a good fail-safe for everybody to understand that if the council cannot agree on a budget for whatever reason, this is a fail-safe for us to move forward in the next fiscal year. Next item I have is the the schedule, and I provided you a copy of the schedule. I know it's a little difficult to read but on the screen, but I do have it in front of you. One of the things I would like to see is the guidelines here. I did put up Monday's January 5th as a time that we can provide the City Council with proposed guidelines from the JBC. And then the City Council will have its work session on the CIP on January 26th. The Council will have a public hearing on the CIP on Monday, February 2nd. The Fire Department, School, and and Police will have their hearings, and I believe they have established those already, and those will be advertised and will probably hear in the chambers and televised. The City Council on February 17th will adopt the CIP, and that will allow me the opportunity to move forward to get the budget to the City Council. In March, you'll have the school board public hearing. I think you have two public hearings, right, Ed? You have two?
Yes.
Yeah. And they'll have that. And during March and part of April, I'll be reviewing the budgets with the department heads to ensure that we are in sync with the guidelines. And then the budget documents are going to be submitted to the City Council on or about April 27th. That's a Monday. And then this is an important date for all departments, including charter departments. On May 2nd, that's a Saturday, the City Council will have its all-day work session. We've done that for the last couple of years now. So you may want to mark that down and make sure you have that on your calendar. Then we have a bunch of work sessions the City Council will have. And it's hoped that the City Council will adopt the budget on Monday, June 8th for the fiscal 16 budget. In fiscal 16 budget, for those of you, we're on a uniform calendar year, uniform fiscal year, and that goes from July 1 to June 30th. So it would be the fiscal 16 budget would be July 1, 2015 through June 30th, 2016. At this time, what I'd like to do is I'd like to have Judy Belanger quickly go through some items that I think are important for the newer members, and I apologize for those who have seen this presentation before, but I think it's important to understand the components of the budget. Many of these slides, you'll see fiscal 15 numbers. It's just to give you an idea of what the macro view of how we approach the budget. And that's purely what you're going to be doing here as a joint budget committee, is look at the macro view. I think each board or commission can look and drill down into their budgets on their own. So I think this will be something that will be of interest to you, and that's why we provided it to you, so you can take with you. And if you have any questions afterwards or anytime, you can give me a call or Judy a call. Judy?
Thank you, John, and good morning, Mayor Lister and members of the JBC committee. I know we're going to be working together on the fiscal year 16 budget. My task today here is to go over the budget process, talk about some of the long-term financial planning tools that we use when we prepare our budget, talk a little bit about the bond rating, and a little bit about the fund balance. Now, this may be a refresher course for a lot of you. I'm hoping that some of this information will be new and informational. As you're aware, the City of Portsmouth has a AAA bond rating, and this didn't come easily. This took several years to obtain the AAA with Standard & Poor's. If you notice, in the mid-90s, on the right-hand side of the screen here, in the mid-90s, had a low bond rating, and it took several years, and it took a lot of financial planning and long-term tools that we've implemented over the last several years to have some upgrades in our bond rating. Since 1999, we've had five increases with Standard & Poor's, and in the same time frame, four increases with Moody's Investors. Now, a good bond rating does several things, but one, it also saves millions of dollars to the taxpayers for our capital improvement needs. We go out to bond, and we save a lot of money on the interest. Now, every time that we do issue bonds, the city manager brings together his management team. We have a meeting with Standard & Poor's, and they rate the community on several criteria. These six criteria are the most heavily weighed during the rating agency process. And they look at several things. They look at our conservative budget techniques. Do we have conservative revenue forecasting? What kind of budget controls do we have in place? They look at debt management policy. Do we have a debt management policy, and how do we manage long-term debt? They look at fund balance policy. They look at fund balance as a total, but they also look at what we'll talk about later is our unassigned fund balance. Do we have a policy? Do we have adequate reserves in order to handle any crisis or unanticipated expenses or shortfall in revenues throughout the year? Some of the items that we don't have a lot of control of here, item number six is strategic planning for economic development. The rating agencies also look at the city as a whole. They look at our demographics, the median household income, our tax base, and some economic growth.
One thing I'd like to just, on number five, the succession and contingency planning, we have put into place a succession plan throughout the organization for key personnel. And we've had a tremendous amount of turnover with retirements, but I think our succession planning has worked very well, and I don't think it has impacted our departments or agencies. So I think we've been able to have a smooth transition. So that is something they look for, too, the succession and contingency planning and the stability of the management team.
Okay, so where do we start when we begin our budget process? And really what it comes down to is what kind of services do our citizens look for and what kind of services do they deserve. And ultimately, the City Council adopts the final budget, and it relays on looking at the services that we provide. Are we going to add some new services? As you recall, maybe in FY15, we did add some additional appropriations for our senior population. We also look at other services. Do we want to reduce or do we want to cut services? Are we going to increase the appropriation, keep the appropriation level, or decrease the appropriation? And of course, any of those would affect the services that are provided to the citizens. But how do we get there? How do we get there is we utilize our long-term financial planning tools. We have the capital improvement plan, which projects out several years for our capital and infrastructure improvements. We look at our financial policies that I'll talk a little bit more in depth, and to keep our budget on an annual basis stable and predictable. We look at our revenue trends. We've had some shortfalls in revenues coming from the state and trying to face some of those challenges in the recent years. We also look at property valuation. And then we look at some of the legal obligations that we have on the expenditure side when it comes to collective bargaining, debt service obligations, and county tax obligations.
These are sometimes referred to as fixed costs, and some people object to the term fixed costs. So we try to explain to you what those, you know, as we go into it further, you'll see what these costs are and how they cannot be changed. The real areas that can be affected by the JBC and the City Council in the end would be mostly in the staffing side of the budget.
So real quickly, we're talking basically about the general fund. The general fund is broken into two parts that we talk about often is our operating side of the budget and our non-operating side of the budget. The operating side of the budget, I listed here all the departments. And on the non-operating side, we have the debt service, overlay, capital outlay, county, contingency, and the rolling stock. Now, this is the FY15 operating and non-operating budget. I'm not really going to focus on the numbers here. It's just the makeup of the budget itself. Again, the operating side of the budget are day-to-day operations to provide public safety, recreation, education, makes up the bigger part of the total budget, or 78%. The non-operating portion makes up 22%. Now, the city provides services, again, in the public safety area, education, and so forth. And it's not surprising that because we provide a service, that salaries and benefits is going to make up most of the operating budget. So of the $75.7 million, salary and benefits comprise of 84%. 16% would be other things like supplies, transportation, contracted services, utilities. And again, when we prepare our budget, we need a balanced budget. Expenditures equal revenues. So we talked a little bit about the expenditure side. We switch a little bit over to the revenue side. Now, in the state of New Hampshire, we rely heavily on property taxes, that we don't have income tax or other taxes that are provided to the local government side. So we look at the revenues that we do have. Some of our larger revenues would be state revenues for building aid, meals and rooms, highway block grant, motor vehicle registration, school tuition, and parking revenues. Those are our bigger revenues. But to fill that gap between the expenditures and the revenues that we bring in would be the property tax levy, and that makes up 77% of our revenues. Now, I want to focus a little bit more here on the policies. When we talk about long-term planning, and when we prepare our budget, one of these financial tools that I call them really helped in the last 10 or 15 years really stabilize and reduce fluctuation in individual departments and challenges that we face on the appropriation side. I had mentioned this before. I've been working for the city for quite some time and started doing budgets in the finance department in the mid-90s. And when I began, none of these policies were existing. We just started focusing on the unassigned fund balance policy at that time. So these are all fairly new in the last 10 or 15 years. Oops.
And one thing I'd have to say is the importance of these are, give us a stable and predictable budget, a stable and predictable tax rate. And we won't go into the details of that, but I think over the years we've been able to maintain what we call stable and predictable. The rating agencies really like that. They like the idea that we have a rolling stock replacement program. As Judy said, when I arrived here, there was no rolling stock replacement program or any of these were in place. We felt that because of the spikes that took place and the impacts on the budget, for example, leave at termination, and the first year I was here, I believe that most departments would have to freeze their accounts in the last quarter of the fiscal year because they'd have retirements coming up and they would have to pay out for those retirements on the leave accumulated. We have also, since 1996, have grandfathered basically people that before 1996 do have a payout on their leave, and people after 1996 only have their vacation payout. We do recognize our unfunded liability in this area, which was up to $10 million and I believe has been reduced.
Yeah, that's
right. If we didn't put the policies in place and the collective bargaining changes, we probably would have had a $20 to $25 million unfunded liability at this time.
So the city manager did touch base on the leave at termination. I'll kind of go through this quickly because he had mentioned a lot of the changes that we've made in that area, but there were those challenges there, that significant growing liability as a result of all employees being able to receive 100% sick leave payout upon their termination of the services with the city. And then the second challenge was that negative budgetary impact to the operating budget. Back in that time frame in the mid-90s, each individual department had to really focus on and estimate who was going to be retiring in that year and fund that liability directly at 100% within each department. So it was quite a challenge and a lot of fluctuation from year to year. So that first significant growing liability was eliminated, as the city manager had mentioned, through contract negotiations. Employees who are now hired after 1996 and they're about no longer receive that liability. It dramatically has reduced that long-term liability. I don't know if you want to.
Do we have many employees left?
About 23%.
Have on that next slide. I probably can jump over there. If you look down at the bottom of this slide here on the municipal side, and this is as of June 30th, 2014. We've also had some changes leading into 15, so these numbers will change. But municipal, 19%. Police have 18% remaining who are eligible for this payout, fire 33%, and school 20%. So the second challenge with that budgetary fluctuation from year to year was was alleviated by the creation of the Leave at Termination Fund. So back when this was created in 1999, we did an actuarial study. We've also had some updates within that actuarial study in the last several years. And what we did, it was really did a fixed cost budget to each individual department, fire, police, school, and the municipal side. So they budget the same amount of money each year, regardless of if they have anyone retiring or leaving within that year, or if they have several people retiring and leaving within that year. So there was a stabilization fund created from surplus, and we budget, was it $925,000 annual appropriations within that department. On July 1st, we moved that appropriation over to the separate fund, is where we pay any employees who are leaving throughout that year. Now, if there's a surplus at the end of the year, it gets folded into committed fund balance, our reserve for leave at termination. And if there's a deficit within that year, it gets paid from that reserve. So it keeps that department level from year to year.
And what will happen is as people roll off these payouts, the departments may have to fund them for a couple extra years. That was the intent in the beginning, that right. Even if you have nobody left, but you can see in one of the columns,
oh, you
have a
here.
Over to the right, you have the deficit. That we will continue to ask that the departments put that in their budget until you have extinguished that liability.
In another area which often showed spikes and valleys and was a challenge for the departments from year to year is our health insurance. Created in 2002, the Health Insurance Stabilization Fund. And what we did at that time, as you can see from this chart here, you can see the large adjustments from the premiums from year to year. So it was hard to absorb additional costs in one year and then have a decrease in the next year and so forth. So what this policy established is that taking the average of the last 10 years of the guaranteed maximum rate provided to us of the change for health insurance and telling the departments to increase their budget by that percentage. In fiscal year 15, as you can see here, the city portion, this was our estimated cost of the city's obligation for health insurance for the employees. And we asked the departments to increase last year just the guaranteed maximum rate of 2.6%. So the proposed budget for the departments was $10 million. Now, as you can see, that leaves a deficit about $1.6 million. So we anticipated some holiday premium coming in, and then finally at the end of the budget process, we anticipated a deficit of about $1 million. Now, with health insurance can change dramatically throughout the year. One employee leaves or comes on, families, it really changes that estimation. So we wait till the end of the year. And any deficit will come from the health insurance reserve, and any surplus that remains will replenish that health insurance reserve for future
Just
years.
To clarify for people that at home and that are new, the holiday premium was something that was required of the health trust and the school care programs to be returned to communities. The Secretary of State's office through one of their divisions had, and I won't go into all the specifics of it, but had challenged the reserves in the risk pools for the communities. And so as a result, they had reduced the reserves that were required, and therefore there was a holiday premium, they called it, which in the last two fiscal years we received. We don't anticipate any more coming forward at this time, but we don't know. Okay. So my point is that that was a one-time revenue source.
Right. Okay. And the next policy for long-term planning is our debt service policy. This was to keep the debt burden and our operational debt costs at a manageable level. And the city's policy is to use no more than 10% of the annual appropriation towards the net debt service payments. This is described more in this chart, very hard to read on the screen. This table can also be found in the capital improvement plan document and on page 110 of the budget document here itself.
And just a reminder for those that are at home or anybody here, the full budget document is on our website.
So this chart includes both the actual debt and any projected debt in any bond issuances that we haven't actually gone out for. So if we'll focus on FY15 here, If you notice that we have a gross debt of about like $11.2 million, but do we offset that debt service by any revenues coming in from our reserve for debt service or state revenue for our building aid? So the net debt is $7.9 million and or 8.19% of the total appropriations. And we use this tool projecting out into the future. So we want to keep this at a manageable level of under 10%. And this is managed through the capital improvement plan also.
And a couple years ago, we did a major restructuring of our capital plan because we were seeing, we moved some projects around so that we would maintain this number.
Right. And although this 10% level actually is way below the state statute requirements for debt limit, but the policy was made to keep it manageable and keep it at a comfortable level. Some key information and dates when we go through the budget process that we're still waiting for certain information or unknown information even through the budget process. So on the operating side, the New Hampshire retirement rates, we did receive the certified rates for fiscal year 16 and 17, which I'll go over in a minute. Health insurance, we're waiting for the guaranteed maximum rate, usually is available in November and December. The health insurance doesn't lock in their rate until April or May, so we just focus really on the guaranteed maximum rate. COLA, most of our collective bargaining units use the 10-year rolling average of the November Consumer Price Index, and that will not be available to us till mid-December. And then workers' comp premiums are available to us in November and December timeframe. Now, other key information, we are going through the process of a revaluation for this year, and this will be, values will be set as of April 1st, 2015. Going forward in this budget process, we'll be not including any change in the valuation because we really don't know how that's gonna come out through the revaluation process.
One of the things to remember on revaluation, and people have a misunderstanding of revaluation, we don't create more value, we don't create more revenue. If you, I don't know if you can get back to the slide with the pie chart and the revenues. If you look at the number for estimated property tax is $74.2 million. Even if we had a revaluation in fiscal 15, that's the amount of revenue that we would have raised. So you have to think of it, you know, you have a pie chart on the screen saying how much property tax is, but you have to consider that there's one pie that we have, and it really is a total amount. You'd have to think in terms of, okay, let's say next year the total amount of taxes we're going to raise is $75 million. That's what we're going to raise. So some businesses might have a larger share of that, some may have a smaller share of that, depends on the revaluation that takes place, or some homeowners may have a larger share or a smaller share. So it will be less important to talk about the dollar, you know, the $18 on the tax rate. It'll be less important to talk about that, but more important to focus on the property tax levy, because what will happen, typically what happens in revaluation, so for example, if we went through a revaluation this year, and we raised $74 million. We may see the tax rate would probably fluctuate downward a little bit because of the changes that have taken place, because your values would be a lot higher. But you're not raising more revenue. If you say you're going to raise $75 million, and whatever that is, you're still going to raise $75 million. I think people have a misunderstanding, and revaluation just now resets the clock for people in their properties where they've done improvements, where properties are very desirable. You know, we notice now the properties that are very desirable, almost they're in a concentric ring, starting out at the North Church, where you, as a concentric ring, property values are highest here, then they start diminishing as you get closer to the city line. So that's something that will be going on, but it shouldn't affect the budget at all. It shouldn't affect us here. It's a function of what the assessor's office will be doing along in accordance with state statute that requires a revaluation every 5 years now. So it shouldn't affect our thinking on the budget because where some will be paying less in taxes, some will be paying more. It's just the way it is.
then and a couple more items that is really unknown to us during the budget process that we estimate, and that is the county tax obligation. That number really isn't a known number until I actually go set the tax rate in October. And then state revenues, we've had challenges in the past with state revenues. We continue to receive meals and rooms taxes and the highway block grant. Now, I talked about the retirement rate. Again, the New Hampshire Retirement System did certify their rate for FY16 and FY17. And and they usually keep the same rate for two fiscal years. There is an increase in FY16 for our Group 1 employees, our municipal employees, it's 3.71% increase. For teachers, 10.66% increase. For our Group 2 employees, police, 4.27% increase, and fire, 5.12% increase. Now, of course, it's also going to be affected by any COLA adjustments or step increases. Now, one of the biggest challenges that we've faced over the last several years is the contribution from the state of New Hampshire. Now, the state of New Hampshire used to contribute 35% of this rate, and it was only for teachers, fire officers, and police officers. And FY10, they reduced this obligation or this contribution to 30%. In FY11, they reduced this contribution to 25%. And in FY12, they reduced this contribution to zero. So here's a history chart for teachers and the contributions for retirement. The blue bars here represent the state contribution. The yellow bar represents the employee contribution. And then the maroon bar represents the city of Portsmouth's contribution here. So as you can see, that dramatic increase. Over in the next chart here for police and fire, you can see this contribution rising from 11.84% to FY16 at 26.38%. And again, that dramatic increase on the fire contribution. Now, in FY15, had the state continued its contributions at 35%, our appropriation for retirement would have been $1.7 million less than what it is. Over the last 6 years, the city has absorbed over $6.3 million due specifically to this reduction in the contribution from the state. Now, real quickly, the fund balance. Talked briefly about committed fund balance and unassigned fund balance. Our committed fund balance is where we keep our reserves, basically. So these are estimated balances as of June 30th, 2014. We're currently going through our annual audit process, so these numbers could slightly change. Currently, we have a balance of $7 million in the health insurance reserve. If you recall, when I talked about health insurance, we were really kind of anticipating that we may have a deficit of $1 million, so this would come from this $7 million. Leave of termination, $1.5 million, and then future debt service reserve of $10.6 million. Now, historically, we've used for debt service, we've typically used about $1.5 million a year to offset the tax rate from this reserve. If we continue to use that $1.5 million, this will extinguish this $10 million in about fiscal 22. However, we do take surpluses. Sometimes it's the timing of when we issue bonds that we may have that money remaining at the end of the year, and that's where we replenish this reserve. The unassigned fund balance, which was amended by the City Council of February 2013, and really going with guidelines from GFOA in maintaining an adequate reserve, the unassigned fund balance is basically not designated towards anything. So the range of where we want to keep that unassigned fund balance now has been amended to be between 10 and 17%. Currently, we're slightly over 12%. Now, oftentimes I hear that we do not use fund balance, we're not using our fund balance to offset tax rate. This chart goes back to fiscal year 09, where it does show that we do use a combination of committed fund balance and unassigned fund balance to offset the tax rate. Now, the blue bar here is our committed fund balance, and that's where we use our reserves, mostly from the debt service reserve. And then the maroon or purple marks here are the unassigned fund balance. Now, in FY15, we did, during the budget process and before the budget was adopted, the City Council did vote to use $200,000 from unassigned fund balance for capital outlay. So over this course, we've used close to $16 million to offset the tax rate. And then my final chart here shows the relationship of the bond rating to the unassigned fund balance. When we talked about the bond rating back in the mid-90s, we had a low bond rating, and this shows that correlation. As we increase our unassigned fund balance, also the increase in our bond rating. So you can see that correlation. And again, you know, this is really quite evident of the results of the policies that we've implemented over the last 10 to 15 years.
At this time, does anybody have any questions of Judy or I relative to the process, the information we provided you? I think it was important to give you this this background, so as we go forward, you know what some of the significant cost items are within the budgets, and what is something that we have control over. With regards to staffing levels, that of course will rest with the individual boards and commissions, and will also then ultimately rest with the City Council and as they go through and adopt the budget. We would like to, at this time, maybe establish a couple meetings. I was talking to the mayor about, I think we're going to have to meet a couple times before the end of, maybe three times before the end of the year, if we can come up with a recommendation to the City Council before the end of the year. And I was, maybe we can check our calendars. I was thinking about November 25th, that's a Tuesday morning. No, that's a Wednesday, is that a Wednesday? Let me see. November 25th, so
Tuesday.
No. Tuesday, yeah. November 25th, Tuesday. Is it Tuesday? And let's see. And also December 2nd. And then going out further into December, I don't want to have anything. Obviously Christmas week, but maybe the week of the 15th. Can people do a Wednesday on the Wednesday, December 17th?
Those meetings would be at 8 o'clock here, and they will all be televised.
Would it only be going to 9 o'clock?
Yeah, we're going to try to keep them to nine, because I think, and that's why we put the public comment at the end, because you know I'll stay and Judy and you know I and if others have to leave, then certainly they can leave and we can take the minutes and respond to people if they have questions. That's why we put the public comment at the end, so that we'd at least be able to have our meeting. And a couple of things that you saw in the budget presentation that we'll have for you is going to be the health insurance rates, and we're going to have to talk about what level we want to use. We would propose a 10-year rolling average, but because we have last year gone into the reserve to keep the rates lower, I'd still like to try to do the 10-year rolling average for the departments. It will affect the departments, but we can't continue to dig into the reserve without having a major problem later on. So I'd like to get back on the track of the 10-year rolling average. And at the end, of, you know, if things look like we need to digress from that, I'd like to have the City Council be the ones to make that decision. The other things we'll have is the CPI, probably mid-December, and we'll be putting the budget together. Hopefully by the time we meet on the December 17th, we'll have like probably a draft of the major numbers together so that the JBC can make some kind of recommendation to the City Council.
Chief, the 25th is the holiday, Thanksgiving week. I won't be in town, so I don't know if you can move it to the week before or if that's too early.
Let me see.
We probably won't have numbers.
Yeah, we won't have numbers
then. The week after.
Okay. We'll be into December.
Then the commissioner, will take notes. And
so, the, okay.
Yeah, I'd like to just keep us on track. If people can't make it, we'll make sure you get the information. Okay. Send somebody to take notes. It is going to be televised, yep. So you can go back and watch it, or you can watch it from wherever you are.
So just to reiterate the dates, we have November 25th, December 2nd, and December 17th, 8 to 9 a.m.
And it's televised. And I did provide everybody a list of the members on the board. If before you leave, could you see Shirley and at least write the email address that you prefer? Okay.
Anyone have any questions about the process, about any information so far? We will certainly be available, Judy, Mr. Bohanko, and myself, if you have any questions after today. If not, I'd like to move on the other agenda item here, which is an opportunity for public comment, and that will be available at all of our subsequent meetings. So if there's anyone in here in the public who would like to speak, I don't see anyone sitting here, but certainly we know that eventually we will get some feedback from individuals, and that's fine. Mr. Bohanko, anything else?
No, I think we're going to, you know, I think it should be a good experience for all of us to know what each of departments are facing. One of the things that we will be facing, other than the retirement and the COLA, will be utilities, especially in the electrical end. We have locked in a rate, though, until after the first of the year, but as you're well aware, the electrical rates are going to be spiking 20% to 30% for a number of reasons in New England. And so we're watching that closely, and as you're aware, we have been working with the departments to go out and find the best bid on electrical provision of power. So that's something we're doing, and probably talk about that the next JBC.
And the agenda for the next meetings will be out prior to the meetings.
So yes, we'll try to get it out a few days ahead. That's why I need your email, so we make sure we get it to the right email address, and so that we can limit the paper that you've provided.
Thank you very much, everyone. Appreciate your time and your willingness to work as part of the JBC. Thank you.
So if you could see Shirley and just give your email address to her, we'll be all set.
And we are adjourned. Thank you very much.
Perfect.